come a long way in 3 weeks. Hopefully, you have a much better understanding of where the financial statements come from and how accountants think about things like revenues and expenses, assets and liabilities. Having that understanding allows you to compute the various ratios as we did in week 3 to get some insight into the firm's financial performance and financial health. You may have noticed that all those activities of the first 3 weeks really focus on the past, on what the firm has done in the past month or year, and how we record and present and evaluate that past record. Well, this week we want to look into the future. We want to think about how we can take all that information we've gathered about the past and forecast what the firm is likely to do in the future. We capture these predictions in a financial forecast, our topic for this week. While there are many different ways to create a financial forecast, most forecasts begin by projecting sales for the upcoming year, since sales captures the major activity of the firm and the level of sales will tend to drive so many of the other expenses, assets, and liabilities. After projecting sales, the next steps require forecasting the operating expenses, cost of goods sold, selling, general, and administrative expenses, R&D, interest, and income taxes. After the income statement is finished, the balance sheet is forecast, beginning with assets, followed by liabilities and the stockholders' equity accounts. This is the easiest way to forecast the income statement and balance sheet, but don't think that it's a purely linear process. In practice, you'll always find yourself circling back to adjust an item in order to make sure it's consistent with some of the assumptions that you make later in your forecast. Going back and forth is not at all unusual. Let's start with sales, and let's help out our NEBCO founders by creating a forecast for their second year of operations that they can use when presenting to their current and potential investors. Forecasting sales can be quite challenging when you don't have access to internal documents. Ideally, you'd like to be able to talk with the salespeople who are really closest to their customers and are in the best position to identify trends and predict next period sales. Since most of us don't have that kind of information, what are some of the ways we can project sales? For public companies listed on a stock exchange, there's often a section in the annual report that discusses management's outlook for the coming year. In the 10-K report filed with the SEC, you can look in the management's discussion and analysis section for this kind of discussion. Managers will also talk about their expectations for the future in press releases and quarterly earnings reports, so be sure to check those as well. Finally, try to get your hands on a research report published by one of the equity research outfits, as these will almost always include a pretty good estimate of the next period's sales. You should also review the past several years of sales for your firm to see what the recent trend has been. If a firm shows a recent history of stable revenue growth, and there is no obvious reason to think this will change, you know, like a shift in market preferences or the entrance of a disruptive competitor, then it would be reasonable to forecast based on this trend. If the past history has been influenced by unusual events or acquisitions, then you would need to adjust for these events. NEBCO, like most startups, poses a special challenge as it's new to the industry, has only 1 year of history to work from, and there is likely to be considerable uncertainty as to its future sales prospects. Add to this a management that is typically very optimistic about its future potential. Sales forecasting can become quite a guessing game. The best way to handle this is to create more than one forecast that each describe a different scenario about what might happen to NEBCO in the next year. I'll start with a conservative forecast that assumes 8% sales growth, a lower rate than I'm sure management would like. When finished, we can adjust this forecast to create more optimistic projections and then evaluate them as to which one is most likely. Thus, for year 2, sales will be forecasted at $3,348,000. Moving down the income statement, the next item to forecast is cost of goods sold expense. This number will always have a close relationship to sales and will be driven by both the number of boats that NEBCO thinks it will sell, as well as any expectations they have about whether their manufacturing costs will go up or down. These expectations are usually captured by forecasting cost of goods sold directly as a percentage of sales. In its first year, NEBCO's cost of goods sold was 67.7% of sales, giving a gross margin of 32.3%. I'm sure, like most companies, NEBCO anticipates various improvements in its production process that will lower costs. Let's assume they have a long-term goal of driving down cost of goods sold to the 55 to 60% range, but that they know that will take some time. For year two, they forecast a smaller improvement of a 64% cost of goods sold, which would lead to a 36% gross margin. Next, we can forecast the operating expenses, selling, general, and administrative expenses, what are often referred to as SG&A, and research and development, or R&D expense. Like cost of goods sold, these will often vary with sales. Here we'll assume that the SG&A expenses have both a fixed and a variable component. Let's assume that in year one, the fixed component was $390,000, and the variable component was 10% of sales, or $310,000, which gives us year one SG&A expenses of $700,000. For year two, assume that given the moderate planned sales growth of 8%, NEBCO sees no need to increase fixed SG&A costs, but will add some variable costs, thus forecasting a variable SG&A to be 11% of sales. Thus, SG&A will be forecasted at $390,000 plus 11% of $3,348,000 for a total of $758,000. The last operating expense to forecast is R&D, research and development. Forecasting R&D can be based on a number of different factors, including things like the degree of innovation required in your product and the extent to which such innovation is part of your competitive advantage. I would assume that for a company like NEBCO that believes a large part of its competitive advantage is in their production process, they will want to continue to do whatever R&D is necessary to keep that competitive advantage. In year one, R&D was just under 5% of sales. In year two, they forecast this to increase slightly to a full 5% of sales. Thus, year two R&D expense will be $167,000. At this point, we have NEBCO's income statement forecasted down through operating income, or EBIT. This is a good time to do a quick check on the reasonableness of the forecast by calculating any ratios that you can for year two. Here we can calculate sales growth, gross margin, and operating margin. And we see that we are projecting an increase in operating margin from 4.8% to 8.4%. Hopefully that will be enough to excite our investors, but if not, we may need to find ways to improve that margin.